Mathy is a cursed player, hated when he reached the biggest milestone in the entire game, and only appreciated for it long after it was already too late. He's an exceptional player who, in hindsight, was almost certainly deserving of his achievements. How did he get so good, and why did everyone hate him so much for it? This is a tragic story of Mathy. Mathy began playing in December of 2014, and by 2016 he was becoming pretty good as a Nomad and Hard Rock player. He'd spent the last 2 years playing a ton, and it had paid off with some pretty quick improvement, to the point where he was hitting impressive 400s, when they still weren't all that common. He continued this improvement on Hard Rock and Nomad to the point where, by the end of the year, he was actually able to set the second ever hidden Hard Rock FC onto the Terminus, after only Kakizi, which began to get him some attention. He then got his first 500 near the end of 2016. But although both of these things were important for his growth as a player, 2017 would end up being the year that he had what was probably the most important evolution of his playstyle, when he switched his focus to DT. This, at first, did result in a slight decline in improvement and impressive plays, but pretty quickly he got more comfortable with it, learning to alternate and gaining speed pretty quickly. This resulted in a few impressive plays pretty quickly after starting, like a Yume Chizu extra difficulty FC and a Killer Song FC. Both of these were really impressive, especially so soon after starting DT, but this would only really be the precursor to the insanity that would come later that year. Although, for the time being, after his first impressive DT scores, he slowed down a lot. This meant his switch to DT almost certainly did stagnate his progress a bit. But by June, he was finally beginning to pick up speed again, with some good DT plays. The thing was, though, that even though his DT progress was good, most of the plays pushing him up the rankings were still Hard Rock or Nomad ones. His switch to DT was clearly making his aim better, but for the time being, he still had a long, long way to go until he'd be able to play DT at a high enough level, or even a similar level to his Hard Rock plays. But over the next months, he'd train a lot and get better at both DT and aim in general, to the point where he got into the top 10 by October of 2017. With some really impressive plays, like a Hard Rock number 1 on Daisuke Evolution. It had taken him nearly 4 years, but he'd finally reached the top 10. This proved that he really was quite good, but at this time he still wasn't considered to be number 1 material, since players like Ravis and Kizzy had insane 700 and 800 PP plays that put them well ahead of Mathy's 600s. This meant that something really needed to change for him to get to the top, which it seemed to in December. Since December would almost certainly be Mathy's most insane month ever, and probably one of the biggest pop-offs any player's had, period. Where, in just a few days, everything changed. It seemed like some insane DT skill in him was just released, because he set 2 700s and 7 600s. This was not only insane by his standards, but by even the standards set by Rapis and Vaxxay at the time. His top play literally went from a 682 on Daisuke to a 781 on Santasan. This gave him a very sudden boost to number 7, although there still was the question of whether or not it was a fluke, since in the months prior he'd had so many less insane plays. But it would soon become obvious just how wrong that was, when in January it was only more of the same, with a 700 and many 600s. And by the time February rolled around, it was pretty clear that he was really good, but after going through the first half of the month with only 3 600s, he once again had one of the biggest pop-offs ever, where he set 2 800 PP plays in just 2 days. By this time, 800s were slightly more common, but still, a player getting 2 in such quick succession was unusual, to say the least. And on top of that, both of the plays were within 10 PP of the PP record, which had only been taken by FG Sky a few weeks before. This was pretty insane, and it also brought him to number 3, meaning that he'd had an almost unprecedented rise in the rankings. A rise which began to raise some suspicion. Suspicion which didn't seem to deter him, since during April he would continue grinding the rankings, until finally, with over 700 spectators on the 15th of April, he took the number 1 spot. Which seems incredible, but it would end up being the catalyst for what would essentially be the downfall of his Osu career, because of the massive hate mob it spawned around Mathy. A mob which had two main sides. First, there were the people who thought he was hacking, which is actually a pretty sizable portion of people. And although it's a pretty awful assumption to make, it did sort of make sense in a way, since at the time Mathy had a pretty bad setup, which didn't allow him to stream without a huge increase in latency, This meant that when he didn't stream, he set insane scores, and when he did, he played terribly. This caused him to stop streaming after only a couple of attempts. But just before he'd gotten number one, he finally got a better computer that made him capable of streaming. The thing was that he still didn't do it often, which probably only contributed more to the suspicion. Especially since he got number one, surrounded by people like Keezy and Rapids who had streamed forever with a hand cam, which just made him seem really out of place. And this wasn't just it, because on top of this, a lot of people thought that he farmed too much. It was a sort of weird point to get him on, since at the time both Rathis and Kakizi were DT farming as well. A bit less than he was for sure, but they also weren't trying to reach number one while passing two of the best established players ever. This was also combined with an incident, in which he test played a Sotarks map and got him to edit it, just to be comfortable for him. But even this wasn't really that crazy, especially since in the past, very similar things had happened with other number one players. Which really makes me think that although people didn't want to say it, a lot of the hate towards him was just because they didn't like the change. It was too much, too quickly. And people didn't like to see players that they had followed for years be passed so casually by someone who wasn't even in the top 10 6 months before. And this massive amount of new hate, combined with him starting streaming only a few weeks prior, meant that Matthew went from seeing almost no hate to being bombarded with it nearly every time he played. This wouldn't be good for any player, but it was especially bad for one who had so much attention thrust on him so quickly. And this all seemed to crescendo when someone made a fake post saying that Matthew admitted to cheating, which showed no evidence and really had no basis in reality. It was so absurd, in fact, that under it, Matthew put, "Yes, I am," as a joke. The thing was that this post would end up getting hundreds of upvotes, and it went for a good while without being noticed by the moderators, after which it was finally corrected. This only hurt his reputation more, and that, combined with his inexperience with having this much negative attention, resulted in Matthew becoming really demotivated and basically quitting. This, in hindsight, is pretty tragic, since even though he'd gotten a number one by farming, it was by no means his only skill. He'd literally gotten his highest PP plays from Hard Rock Stream farm maps only a few months prior, and he'd proved that even back then he could compete with the best on those maps. And although his top DT plays were certainly farm maps, they were also longer, more consistency-based ones that wouldn't be matched until Vaxxay came back in 2019. And who knows how good he could have gotten if he'd remained active. Which he didn't. Since, after the end of 2018, he went from semi-active to almost completely inactive. And the funny part is that he was so far ahead in terms of PP that until his complete inactivity, he remained at number one. And even after an entire year of barely booting up the game, he was still number 15. But it seemed like finally, in 2019, when he hit this rank, he had a change of heart. Realizing that most of the people who hated him before were six digits, who really had no place to judge how good he was. Or if not that, they were Kakizi or Rapis fanboys, upset that he had passed them. And so, with some newfound motivation, he began his gradual rise back to the top. He started off with some mid-600s that were pretty much de-rusting for what he'd do next, which was an 800 PP play on Start Again. By this time, this was a much less mind-blowing number, since farm maps had evolved a lot, but still, getting an 800 after only a week or two of de-rusting was a pretty good sign of the plays that were to come. Which they did, when he got an Ah FC for 866 PP, an I Know Tsukima FC for 823, and a myriad of 700s, all in only the next few weeks. And then it all seemed to culminate in March, when he had one of the best weeks in his career, setting not only six separate 800s, but also a completely absurd 900 on Union. This made it abundantly clear that Matthew had not only come back just as good as before, but better. And even with the new insanely competitive farm meta, he was one of the best, climbing 10 ranks in 2 months. During this time, he also didn't just make it clear that he could still farm DT, but he also set a bunch of insane stream and finger control scores, with multiple 700s and even an 800 on both Wings of Justice and the new Road of Resistance. These scores were cool, but they also weren't really unprecedented, since he'd always been quite good at stream maps. But one score that stood out a bit more was his Reason FC, since the map only had a handful of FCs, and his was the best ACK, with an almost metronomic 99.72% accuracy. All of this makes a pretty good case that Matthew isn't a DT one trick. And although it is probably his strongest skill, scores like this make it pretty clear that farming isn't anywhere near his only one. The story of Mathy is a pretty tragic one. A player who spent longer than most players training to become the best was immediately labeled as a one-trick and a farmer by much of the community, largely because of things that were outside of his control or mistakes that he'd made months prior. His losing motivation in the game was only natural after that, and in doing so, we lost one of the best DT players of all time, and a player who almost certainly could have become stupidly dominant at so many skills if he'd kept playing. But, hopefully, the community as a whole can learn from this, and next time someone new shows up at the top, they can actually be appreciated for who they are as a player, and not who they've unfairly passed in the rankings.